Hello and welcome to this GCSE Project C. Designed to get you ready for your GCSE studies, it focuses on World War I and medical progress. You will need the lesson notes booklet that goes alongside this. You may print it out and write in it. You may type into it electronically, or you might just read it and write your notes in response to the tasks on a piece of paper. You will find it on Pod, you will find it on Class Charts, you will find a link to the document in the description of this video. So, without further ado, alright, the first thing we're going to do is have a look at a bit of an inference exercise, which is task 1. What can we infer from this painting about the medical conditions on the Western Front during World War I? Remember, when we are inferring, we are drawing a conclusion from the evidence that we can see in front of us. So we make an inference and then we support it with something from the source. In this case, we must support that inference with a reference to something in the painting, something that we pick out that leads us to think something about the medical conditions on the Western Front. So you need to pause this video now and have a go, and then we'll come back in a moment. Okay, welcome back. So, what can we see from this source? What can we infer? One thing we can infer is that this dressing station, which was close to the front line, was outdoors. So we can infer that medical provision was often had to be made on the spot. It wasn't a hospital as such. Medical provision had to be provided in some very open air emergency situation. What else can we infer? We can infer that there was a large number of casualties that were required to be treated. What else can we infer? We can infer that the conditions were potentially unhygienic and potentially they were not sterile, that's for sure. We've got a dressing station here outside with men lying on the floor. What else can we infer? We can infer that the medical conditions were particularly problematic for medics. You can see some of the medics trying to treat various people. The overcrowding of the situation would make that difficult. And performing any sort of operation or giving any sort of first aid would be difficult in those circumstances. Okay, the key to this particular module that this project refers to, which is the module on the First World War surgery, treatment and injuries, is to make a link between the conditions that were faced by men on the Western Front in the First World War and the types of injuries they had and the medical problems. So the reason why this particular module is about the historic environment is we're trying to see how the environment in which the war was taking place had an impact on the types of injuries and the types of medical problems that men faced. So in task 2, you are going to be looking at the types of conditions on the Western Front, and you're going to be looking at some of the key features of those conditions. Now, as you can see from these pictures, we know that the First World War was trench warfare. And so this trench warfare is taking place in farmland in France and Belgium. And what we know about farmland is that it is rich in manure because it has often had cattle grazing on it. And so one of the things that you need to consider when we're thinking about how the environment in which the men are fighting has an impact on the type of medical problems is when there are explosions, when men are hit by shrapnel, flying metal, then that explosion carries with it soil, part of the field, part of the ground, and that is infused with manure. And if that gets inside the human body, which it will if a shrapnel is forced in there because of an explosion, then that is going to take with it bacteria, which is going to cause infection. So what we need to consider about trench warfare is the specific medical problems that were created as a result of that environment and the way in which men were fighting. So The next few tasks in this project are going to ask us to first of all think about the type of conditions that men were fighting in, and then you are going to be required to make a link between that and the medical conditions. So in a moment you need to pause this, use the information that's in task 2, and jot down some key ideas about the features of warfare on the Western Front. Okay, so you should have a good idea now of some of the types of conditions, type of warfare that men faced on the Western Front. And we're going to start to link that to the specific medical problems that were caused by those conditions. I've already mentioned infection to you and the problem caused by the environment in which the men were fighting. Have a look at this little video link before you start task 3, which explains that in a bit more detail.
No, he's already tubed, it's fired.
As an emergency medicine doctor and a former army officer, I'm really fascinated to learn about the challenges faced by frontline war medicine a century ago. During World War I, we saw devastating injuries caused by gunshots, shrapnel, and poisonous gas. But one of the major killers of the time was infection, and it always had been. Misconceptions about how to successfully treat and manage war wounds had often led to doing more harm than good. Today, I have an amazing opportunity to look at original World War I research into infection at the Army Medical Services Archive. There's all sorts of information about the treatment of common infections such as trench foot, a really nasty fungal infection caused by cold, damp and unclean conditions. One of the things that you realise when you start looking into this area is that many of the problems that were being faced were linked with real practical situations. Take, for example, the trenches. They were dug mainly in France on farmland. And what does farmland have? Soil enriched in manure. So imagine that, dirty wounds, open wounds, contaminated by manure and in the soil. So once they'd identified this, they could really work towards finding a solution to deal with the problem. One of the specific infections caused by the bacteria in manure was gas gangrene, which frequently resulted in amputation and sometimes loss of life. A solution was needed. For me, one of the most important figures in World War I medicine was the British bacteriologist Amros Wright. Now, he proposed revolutionary methods in how to treat war wounds, and his research was dedicated to that. The thing about war, unfortunate and tragic though it is, it forces medical research to accelerate through need, but it also provides a huge number of subjects to research with. Wright was vigorously opposed to the traditional method at the time of pouring antiseptic into a wound and then closing it up. His research from these vast number of case studies from the battlefields of Europe was vital in persuading his peers that his approach was the way ahead. His method suggested that wounds would be opened, all foreign bodies removed, a wide bore drainage tube inserted, and a sterile hypertonic 5% saline solution be used to promote the flow of lymph. Basically, what he was saying was get rid of all the shrapnel, get rid of all the grubby bits of French soil, give it a really good clean, and then leave the wound open, and then allow the body's natural healing process to work. And what I find really interesting is that, to me, reading that now, as a doctor today, it seems so obvious. Hindsight is a wonderful thing. And I know there are things that we are doing today, maybe that doctors in the future will go, oh, I can't believe they were doing that. Well, I am kind of having that moment now with the techniques that were originally being used by the surgeons until Wright pushed forward the frontiers of medicine with his research. Because of the resistance to Wright's research, it wasn't until after the war that his theory on wound cleaning was fully adopted. In World War II, they contributed significantly to the lower rates of infection and amputation. Wright's methods on wound cleaning are one of the great medical legacies of World War I.
Okay, so use what you've just seen. Use what you read in task two about conditions at the front, and then read the information on pages 7 and 8 to help you complete task three. Pause me now and have a go at that. Okay, so in task four, what we're going to try and do is apply some of what you have learned in tasks 1, 2, and 3 and think about how that can help us to consider how useful a source is and how we can analyze a source. So you can see here, source A, this is from A Frenchman in Khaki by Paul Mays that was published in 1934. Mays was an artist who was with the French and British armies during the First World War, and in this particular source he's describing the treatment for wounded soldiers. Alright, what I want you to do, have a look at it, consider what is in the source that matches with what you already know. So what makes this source useful just in terms of its content? Okay, so pause this, have a look at it. Pick 2 or 3, maybe 4 things out of the source that you think are useful, but importantly, you're going to support why they are useful with your own knowledge that you've gleaned from tasks 1, 2, and 3. Okay, welcome back. Hopefully you've had a little go yourself at doing this and you have not cheated by just not pausing it and waiting for me to reveal some of the things that you could have picked out. So, source says, all the wounded men in the ward are in a bad way. I see how nervous they are as the nurses prepare for the surgeon's visit. Some of the men have to be anaesthetized to have their wounds dressed. Well, that's useful content. There we are, that they have to have anaesthetic, so they have to have painkiller just to have their wound dressed. We know from the information that we've gleaned in the first three tasks some of the truly horrific injuries that men had because of explosions, because of shrapnel ripping into their bodies. We know that this industrialized type of warfare caused some horrific injuries. One patient has gangrene and has to be operated on every other day to have a bit more of his leg cut off. We know about gangrene, we know about gas gangrene, we know about infection. We saw that in the video clip about the influence of the work of Arnroth Wright. We know that the type of farmland that they were fighting on, infused with manure, meant that when soil was pushed into wounds by explosions, it caused infection. One boy had both his legs cut off and the nurses watch him constantly. He smells terribly of infection. Again, we're talking about this great problem of infection that caused many deaths among soldiers and it spread through the ward. Sometimes a wounded man will die because he has lost the will to live, even though his condition shows an improvement. So this tells us something about the mental health of the soldiers. We know what industrial warfare did to these men, and we know that this source is useful because it tells us some of the serious problems that faced wounded soldiers in hospital wards, in casualty clearance stations, in dressing stations during the First World War. And the provenance of the source, I didn't ask you to look at this, but it's worth noting that the provenance of the source, where it comes from, Paul Mays was stationed with the French and the British Army during the First World War. So here's a guy who was actually there, who was in the know about the conditions that men faced. Right, what we're going to move on to in task 5 is a bit of a case study of specific medical treatment that soldiers received that developed during the First World War. So because of the conditions that soldiers faced, and because of the conditions that medics faced, then there was a drive to improve medicine, and that drive focused on areas that were specifically difficult for medical staff during the First World War. So this type of warfare, this industrial warfare, threw up specific types of medical problems, and so the progress that was made throughout the war was in addressing these particular problems. And one of the particular problems that was thrown up by this industrialized warfare was the problem of the horrific facial injuries that people suffered as a result of explosions, shrapnel, artillery shells, etc. And so therefore there was a real need to try and improve plastic surgery and reconstructive surgery and brain surgery. We're going to focus specifically on plastic surgery, which is what task 5, the information there, focuses on. Before you look at the written information, have a look at this clip, and I will warn you that there are some disturbing images in the clip.
It's something we take for granted today, reconstructive surgery. People rebuild, augment, or reduce parts of their bodies by the millions. 100 years ago, though, it was in its infancy. And indeed, it was the First World War that saw the rapid development of modern plastic surgery. I'm Indy Neidell. Welcome to a Great War special episode about plastic surgery and the First World War. And I have to say, for this episode, viewer discretion is advised. During the war, weaponry and military technology were leaps and bounds ahead of surgical technology. This was particularly the case with regard to the faces of soldiers and sailors that had been damaged by bullets or shrapnel. If you think about it, trenches protected bodies better than they did heads. A soldier who peered out over no man's land could well get a facial injury from an enemy sniper, though exploding shells and shrapnel were the chief causes of facial damage. A surgeon from New Zealand named Dr. Harold Gillies, eventually Sir Harold Gillies, studied medicine at Cambridge and was shocked by the facial injuries he saw in the British Army Medical Corps. He took the initiative in plastic surgery and eventually set up a specialist hospital in London. Although there were plastic surgery techniques that date back 2,000 years, modern plastic surgery developed and advanced quite rapidly during the war, as Gillies and his team of surgeons performed some 100,000 operations on around 5,000 men. Multiple surgeries were required back then, in the days before antibiotics, when skin grafts and open wounds had a high rate of infection. Gillies overcame the infection problem by actually moving living tissue from one part of the body to another. And this process could take years and many surgeries. One method involved embedding rib cartilage on the forehead, and when that surgery had healed, the cartilage was swung down to form the nose. The real trick was to keep the tissue connected to the body's bloodstream and immune system, and allow skin to grow its natural waterproof protection. This sounds pretty radical, doesn't it? But perhaps the most revolutionary procedure was the development of the tube pedicle. This involved forming human tissue into tubes in some place like the shoulder, and then walking the tube to the face. It's anchored at both ends, and then you sever one end and reconnect it closer and closer to the face. This process was invented by Gillies. It actually looked like the handle on a piece of luggage, and the process of moving it was called waltzing the tube pedicle. Gillies and his team set up their plastic surgery hospital in Sidcup, southeast of London, and Gillies got a war permit to travel around France to study things there, like cosmetic rhinoplasty. In the public areas near the Sidcup hospital, blue benches were set up where the wounded men could sit without the public having to look at them, which protected the patients from the horrified stares. And mirrors were not provided for patients because many of them would collapse in shock at the sight of their own faces. European surgeons from before the war had a strong influence on Gillies and plastic surgery, as he acknowledged, though he was the first to practice reconstructive techniques in Britain. There were plastic facilities on the continent during the war, of course, in places like the Center for Maxillofacial Surgery in Lyon, Jacques Joseph's Section for Facial Plastic Surgery at Charité Hospital in Berlin, and the Dusseldorf Hospital for the Facially Injured. And August Lindemann was writing publications hoping to improve the facially injured soldiers' initial frontline care. Dr. Gillies and his team took loads of before and after photos, and you can find many such photos searching on the internet. What they document is that a soldier, literally with his face blown off, could years later have a normal looking face. Again, plastic surgery was still in its infancy, so many soldiers did not get a normal looking face in the end, nor survive the many surgeries. One success story was Lieutenant William Spreckley, whose face was damaged at Ypres. He spent over 3 years at the hospital, and you can see the process of repairing his face to a normal-looking face over the course of multiple surgeries. Eventually, people could not even tell his face had been reconstructed, and the older he got, the more natural his face looked. If, for some reason, a disfigured soldier did not get a good result, he was provided with a mask. These were usually made of copper or tin and were held on with straps or attached to eyeglasses. Sculptors and artists achieved notable success forming and painting the masks to approximate the color of facial skin. At Third London General Hospital in Wandsworth, Francis Derwent Wood made metal masks in what became known as the Tin Noses Shop. Wood made custom-designed masks and prosthetic attachments using pre-war portraits of his patients. American sculptor Anna Coleman Ladd did pretty much the same thing for French and American soldiers at her studio for portrait masks in Paris. Of course, facial expressions were either partly or wholly obscured, though grateful letters were sent to the makers of the masks because they allowed some soldiers to re-enter normal life. And that was a big problem with disfiguring facial wounds, and many of those men had sad fates. They referred to themselves as broken gargoyles. Veterans who came home with a mask would quite likely send their own children running in fear and revulsion, and apparently, hospitals for amputees were cheerful in comparison to the facial reconstruction hospital. Patients leaving the hospital could face serious difficulties in life. Many sought employment that allowed them to work out of sight of others. Marriages could break up. Single men with disfiguring injuries could be unable to find a mate. And social isolation and shame for these men often resulted. It is not without some truth to say that for those who had these wounds, perhaps the most horrible wounds of the war, it was a fate worse than death. A soldier lost his identity, his pride, perhaps his wife, attractiveness in general, the willingness to work, play, and socialize with other people. The face is the home to your feelings, personality, emotions, romantic attachment, age, ethnicity, identity, communication, and more. And when war takes away someone's identity, though they survived its battle horrors, you can really see its true cost. Alcoholism, isolation, depression, and suicide were the fates of many of these men. Today, plastic surgeons can quickly work miracles, and there is no question that those miracles began during the First World War, and many began with Dr. Harold Gillies. He is very much an unsung hero of the war, and at least there is the consolation that something good, something very important in our modern world, came out of this war with all its slaughter and misery. This episode was shot.
Okay, so now we want to turn to the written information on task 5. I want you to read that. I want you to consider what you've just seen in the video clip and then answer the question at the bottom of task 5, which says, how much did plastic surgery improve? So you probably need to balance that answer slightly. How much did it improve? Well, it improved in some respects, and you can write down the ways in which it did, but there were also some limitations to how much things improved. So pause this now and have a go. And so we come to task 6. Now, by now, you should have a good idea of what conditions were like on the Western Front, the impact that had on the different medical problems that were faced by soldiers and medics, and some of the ways in which those medical problems were overcome, with specific focus on plastic surgery. You're going to look at two sources now, and you're going to consider which is the most useful for inquiry into improvements in plastic surgery in World War I. Now, this template here, to help you consider how useful sources are, should be familiar to you if you completed GCSE Ready Project A. The important thing when you're answering this question, and there are one of these questions on the Germany paper 3, and there is one of these questions on the medicine and World War I surgery, which is paper 1. The important thing is to think about what the source shows us and what is useful about that in the context of our own knowledge, and then to think about the provenance of the source, who wrote it, where does it come from, when, what was its purpose, and what is useful about that, given the context of what we know. So, I'm going to give you slightly less help to start off with than I gave you when we did Project A. You need to pick two or three things out from the source, the content of it. You know, that should be quite easy for this source because it is a photograph. And think about what in the contextual knowledge you have that makes that useful. And then think about the provenance, where it comes from, and think about what makes that useful, and also potentially some limitations. And do the same for the second source here, which this time is a written source. Go through the source. Pick out some key quotes, some key bits of the source. Think about what the source shows us in relation to improvement in plastic surgery. And then think about what we have as contextual knowledge to help us show that that is useful. Think about the provenance of the source. Think about what makes that useful, but also think about limitations. So you want a sort of decent sized, chunky paragraph of content and provenance in the context of knowledge for one source, and the same for the other. So maybe before you start writing your ideas, it would be a good idea to look at the sources, jot a few ideas down. If you printed this booklet off, then you could annotate the sources. If not, then just bullet point some ideas about the content and the provenance of the source. So you want to pause this now, and then when you come back, I will give you a little bit more help before you start writing your answer. Right, welcome back, source analysis fans. Let's have a look at this one then. Things I would have picked out from the source, there's only one main real thing you could pick out, you could then elaborate on it further, is that we see here a photograph which shows some success. We could pick out from the source that on the left hand side there's quite a terrible facial wound, and by the time we get to the right hand side we can see that that wound has healed. In our contextual knowledge, we could say that we know that some of this sort of plastic surgery was successful and there was ability to improve facial features this way. We could talk about some of the specific examples of Harold Gillie's experiments. And we could say in relation to the content that this shows us about the different stages that a patient went through in order for their facial reconstruction to work. And again, we use our contextual knowledge about the work of Gillies and the tube pedicle and all the different ways in which he perfected being able to reconstruct people's faces. Now, the provenance of the source is useful because it comes from Harold Gillies. It was published in 1920, so he's publishing it 2 years after the end of the war. It's fresh, it's his ideas at the time of the conflict, or just after. So that makes it very useful. However, it is a surgical textbook by him, and he is showing people how you can reconstruct somebody's face. And so there's a slight limitation there in the sense that in that textbook, he is not going to show you a picture of how it went wrong. He is showing you the pictures of the successful cases, of which there were many. However, we also know that there were many unsuccessful cases. So there's a slight limitation if we think about the provenance. And that limitation is exposed to a certain extent by this source. So we'll come to that in a moment. We have the soldier said to his nurse, "I don't want my girlfriend to come until I get rid of these bandages. It would scare her to death to see me lying here looking like an Egyptian mummy. We had done a reasonable repair job considering the amount of flesh and skin he had lost. Mirrors were banned from the ward, but he had a small shaving mirror in his locker. When he saw himself after the bandage had been removed, he collapsed. All hope of allowing his girlfriend to visit him ended. And then on, he insisted on being hidden from the rest of the patients on the ward. When at last he went home, it was to live a solitary life." So here we see some things in the source that are useful. So it talks about how much flesh and how much skin he had lost. So we know again from our own knowledge, industrial warfare, this was likely to make plastic surgery very difficult. And it also says there that he was wrapped in many bandages and mirrors were banned, and we know that for many patients the reconstruction process, the plastic surgery process, was very long, very arduous, very difficult. In this particular source, this soldier does not want his girlfriend to visit him. He is horrified when he sees himself in the mirror. It leads to him having a very, very depressing and difficult life after he leaves hospital. So the usefulness of this is it shows us the other side of the ability of plastic surgery to deal with some of the wounds that soldiers had. So in the photographs that we saw in the first source, that was a success story. This tells the story of something that wasn't that successful, and we know that of all the work that Harold Gillies and others did, whilst there were successes, there were also problems, and there were certain things that could not be fixed, and Gillies acknowledges this. This provenance is from Gillies, Surgeon Extraordinary, a biography by Reginald Pound, published in 1964. Gillies here is remembering a particular case. So this is Gillies himself speaking about the problems and speaking about the operations when they went wrong or they did not succeed to the extent that we see in the photograph. So this tells us the other side of the coin. This tells us about the other element of the story, that for the success cases, there were also some cases where soldiers were not happy with the results of the plastic surgery, and also the plastic surgery could only do so much. And Gillies acknowledges that he is not able to create miracles. So both sources are useful, given their content in the context of what we know, and they are both useful in their provenance because they're from Gillies in different ways, again, and we know that that is useful because of what we know about Gillies. And they are useful for an inquiry into improvements in plastic surgery because they reveal the reality of those improvements. That yes, indeed, there were improvements, but there were also great difficulties and limitations to what Gillies and other plastic surgeons could do. So, task 6 asks you to write your answer to that question, how useful are these sources for an inquiry into improvements in plastic surgery? Use the template in front of you, use the ideas that we have just discussed, write your answer, and when you have done so, feel free to send it to your teacher and they will have a look at it and give you some feedback. And there we have it. That brings us to the end of GCSE Ready Project C. If you have completed Project A, B and C, you will be starting to get a good insight into the different aspects of the GCSE course by dipping into some of the different modules and looking at some of the key issues and key topics. And you're also starting to get a sense of the skills required to be successful at GCSE. So, hope you've enjoyed that. Hope you have learn something new. And until next time, take care, stay safe, see you later.